So we're gonna plug 5 in here for the x, 4 minus 3/5 times 5. And as Marcus said, we can cross cancel. Yeah.
I forgot to graph them. Like I did them all, and then I spaced. I don't see graph, so I.
That's exactly what I did.
Okay. Well, then on your homework, I'm gonna write the word grass with a question mark. We do need to be careful. You know, I assigned it. The reference says graph. I know we've been filling out tables, but it does say the instructions to graph. And you can. If later you decide that like 4 out of 5 on that one whole assignment is really killing you, then you can redo it if you wanted to.
We can redo it
all
the time.
Okay. So if we cross cancel the 5 and 5, we're left with a 1 and a 1 there. That's just a 3. 4 minus 3 is 1. So we plugged in a 5, right, for x. That means that y is 1, x is 5, y is 1. What's another number that would be nice?
10.
10's a great one. 10. 4 minus 3/5 times 10. Now we get cross-canceling, but when we divide 10 by 5, we are left with a 2. So 3 times 2 is 6, and that's a negative 6. Negative 3 times 2 is negative 6. 4 minus 6. Is negative 2. So x was 10, that caused y to be negative 2. So the point that we can plot here would be x is 10 and y is negative 2. There you go. So you see a pattern in these points. What pattern is that?
Go up by 5.
The x's go up by 5 and?
Down 3, 4.
Okay.
Down 3.
Down 3. Over 5, down another 3. If I move over 5 and down 3 consistently, what shape do those points following that pattern make?
Straight line.
Okay. Not all graphs make that kind of a shape, right? Because not all of them have that kind of a pattern. All graphs have their own special patterns, but other graphs have more complex patterns than this one. This one has a pretty simple pattern. Go to the right 5, you go down 3. Okay? If I go just half that much, if I go half of 5, I go 2.5, right? I only went over 2.5. Go down 1.5. Just half as much in the vertical as well. So if I go over half as much and come down half as much, and I'm still right there on that line. Can you give me another point, or another x value that would work nicely? 15. I'm going to not do 15, only because my graph paper doesn't go out to 15. So I'm trying to force you to pick numbers that people don't typically pick. Right?
I just had a question. Mm-hmm. So on the homework, you don't have to do these exact numbers, right?
No.
Can you go to negatives?
Wait. So.
About what?
Like, if you're doing this and it's like the right answer, like I didn't do it either. Like I did like negative 1 and 0 and 1.
That's what I did.
So, I didn't get the same thing you got. So.
Well, no matter what you did, now choosing 1 and negative 1 make it so that this nice cancellation doesn't happen. That's okay, because anything can be plugged in for x. All that happens to x is get multiplied by the negative 3/5. I can't think of any reason why I wouldn't be able to multiply 1 by the negative 3/5, right? Any number can be multiplied by negative 3/5. So any number can be plugged in for x. 1 is certainly a valid option. Negative 1 is certainly a valid option. It's just that when you go to graph those points, when you get the y value, what you're going to wind up plotting is some kind of an off fraction that is not very pleasant to plot. The graph should be the same, and that's really what the homework is about, is finding the graph. And that should produce the same graph. That's it. For another value of x we can plug in that would make the calculations pretty easy.
Can you do 1?
You can. You can plug in 1, but the 1 is not going to make the calculations easy.
11.
11?
You can't go past your graph.
True. So it must be, there is an option available. options available that
12 and 11
that we're not missing.
11.
Or we're not getting. We're not seeing it.
Oh, negative.
Negative what?
Negative
10. Sure, negative
10. Five.
Negative 5.
Oh my god.
How about -5 and -10? Okay, so 4 minus 3/5 times -5. Well, okay, keep in mind the negatives. 5 divides -5, leaving us with a -1 there. So we have -3 times -1, what's that? -3 times -1 is +3. 4 plus 3 C's in there, 7. So -5 is what we put for X, and it gave us a Y of 7. So -5, 7. -5, 7. -10, 4 minus 3/5.
We have to do as much as this?
No.
Oh.
I did like.
He's making a point here. What point am I trying to make?
That's never ending.
Okay, it's never ending. That's one point that could be, certainly a lesson we could take from it. Harry. What's another lesson?
They all
but you're always
tie in
right.
Together.
They all tend together. What's that?
You're always right.
Oh, they make a lot.
I'm not trying to make the point that I'm always right. It's not true, and it's very irritating.
What?
It's not true that I'm always right. And
well, I was trying to be nice.
Oh.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm not always right. And I'm not trying to teach you that I'm always right. But I'm trying to get to help you to see. Some of you said, let's try 1 and -1. Do you see 1 and -1 in there?
Yeah.
No.
No.
Yes,
yes,
you do.
Here?
No.
For X.
In between.
No.
No.
It's so confusing.
10, 5, -5.
I like that.
5, -5, 10, -10. Hallie suggested 15. I only didn't do that one because it wouldn't fit. We don't have room for 15.
Well, I said -10.
Okay. So what I'm trying to get you to see is that if we use 5s for the X, well, it makes our life a lot easier. How can I tell that 5s are going to be easy? By looking at this equation, how can I tell 5s would be an easy choice?
Because there's a 5 in it.
Just because there's a 5 in it somewhere?
Sure.
Why
not?
I don't know. I feel like why not is because we're not wasting our time by giggling at things. Cole?
Never mind. That doesn't make sense.
There's a 5.
Yeah, but my other one doesn't make sense.
What is it about choosing 5 or -5 or 10 or -10 that we can be sure are going to work out nicely so we don't have any decimals left over? It's simplifiable because of what? What's equivalent to what? Well, the thing that makes it possible to simplify is that look at this guy here, right here. The denominator is
5.
And the denominator is the thing you divide by, right? So I want the thing that I divide to be divisible by 5. I want to be able to divide that number by 5. So if I plug in a number here, I would like when I try to divide it by 5 and cross divide, cross cancel, I would like that to work. Right? So I want to make sure that number that I plug in is divisible by 5. 5 is divisible by 5. 5 divided by 5 is 10 is divisible by 5. When I do that cross dividing or cross canceling, I'm left with that 2. No more denominator. When I put in a -5, that gets canceled. When I put in a -10, that also gets canceled. 5 divides -10 and leaves a -2. This is the last thing I do, so I'll write below it here. -3 times -2 is a +6.
Excuse me.
So we get 10. -10, 10. -10, 10.
Oh, yeah.
And let's throw a line around. Like I said before, drawing that line is kind of like cheating because what is that line really?
A bunch of dots.
A bunch of dots.
Points.
Points. Good. that's like the math word for it.
Yeah.
A dot is kind of general, a point is specifically part of the graph. That's a dot, but it's not part of the graph. That's a point. It is part of the graph. So it's made up of a bunch of points, and I kind of cheated because did I draw all those points?
No.
But why didn't I draw all those points?
It would take forever.
It would take forever, and we don't have forever. So we cheat a little bit and fill in all of the in between and all, everything past the points with the line that we know that the points would make. Okay, Brandon?
Isn't that the graph, though? Isn't the whole part of the graph? Even the dots.
These?
Are, yeah.
No.
Why?
Well, just because, you know, with anything, you have words and those words are specific. They mean specific things.
But
so a graph is a technicality because as mathematicians, we make the words mean what we want them to mean. And a graph means all of the points.
So
that belong to this equation.
There was a point there before we put the dot there.
No, there wasn't.
There was.
There was a dot there before you put the point.
But there was.
You mean this thing right here?
No, like, yeah, those things were there before I put the point.
Stand up.
We're still doing
it.
No, we're not. Wait, yeah, we are.
This thing before we put points on it, Brandon, I'm answering your question, so it would be nice if you could hear it. These things here, they're not. I'm just getting technical, and you brought it up.
I did.
I'm splitting hairs here, but these are not points. Points, a point.
They're not.
Yeah, they're just like a guide to help you be able to find where the point should go.
Okay, so the points are. There's a dot there before the point was there.
Okay.
So, I don't get it.
If I cover up all these dots, just so that you can stop paying attention to them for a second.
Whoa, I can't see anymore.
Covering up all those dots. Covering up all these dots. The only important part that we want to concentrate on is all of these points. All of these points that make up this graph.
Alright.
The dots that you see before we start doing the graph, I could have put graph paper up here that had dots, didn't have dots, had a grid, had more dots, had fewer dots. Those dots aren't part of the graph. What we had there was just like graph paper, or really what we call it in math is the plane, the flat surface where we put graphs. But the graph's not there until I put the graph there.
Okay.
Alright?
Alright.
I normally wouldn't split hairs with you, but I love splitting hairs. What? You people don't usually love it, but you wanted to do it. So we
did. I do like it.
I like
it. What does splitting hairs mean?
I mean, just getting into the really fine technical details of something that most people don't really care about. Okay? Suggesting that we do it when I don't have it planned, I'm not going to change my mind. It wasn't a suit. It's just the classic. Are we helping ourselves right now?
Maybe not.
Okay.
Just
problem?
Just
sit.
One question. But
one.
You know that extra dextra thing? We don't do that anymore, do we?
I felt like it just kind of turned into this negative thing. I don't know. I'm trying to be more positive, but I also have to correct you. I don't know. So, no.
Okay.
Not right now. Okay. So, the graph is all of the points that would come from, for instance, a table of values. Cool.
do the slope thing.
How could you do the slope thing? So that's what I was talking about with that 5 in the denominator tells me that I want to, if I were to make a table, which I don't always have to do, if I were to make a table, I would want to go to the 5s, 10s, 15s, 20s. I'd want to move over, right, because x is horizontal. I'd want to move horizontally in bits of 5.
Okay.
Right? And so that tells me the half of the slope, the over part, the horizontal part. Okay? Now I see the vertical part here. Okay? Because once this 5 cancels this guy out, all I'm left with is 3 times something. So that number that's left is 3. So when we move over in groups of 5, every time we move over a 5, we move down a 3.
Okay.
And we saw that yesterday, we were noticing that pattern. We see that pattern now in this table. We see it on the graph. If I move over 5, I move down 3. We can just keep that going. I know that the movement is going to be over 5 and down 3. I also can see easily if I plug in 0, I'll get 4. And those two pieces of information are enough to get enough points for us to draw what we know is going to be a line. So I could put the y-intercept there of 4, because 0 is going to give me 4, clearly. You can see that there. And I know from this fraction here that I want to move over 5, and when I do that, I'm going to want to move down 3. And since we're a positive 3/5, so I'm going to move over 5 and up 3. All this stuff that we've been doing with the graphs, and it's all about noticing patterns. For the lines, specifically, we're trying to notice that pattern, the pattern of moving over some and up some, right? The convenient amounts. If I move over 1, I can always go over to 1. It's just that when I plug in 1, it doesn't necessarily give me a nice number to work with. But if I pay attention to the denominator, I can plug in values of x that make it nice to work with. Okay. 24, the other one that we had a question about. That's a good one. So it describes a situation where you go to pick apples, okay? And the admission, what does admission mean?
I don't know.
Entry fee.
Entry fee, yeah. Entry fee is?
Admission.
Aren't you a genius?
Yes, I am.
That's supposed to be an M.
Okay.
Admission is $5.
Shush.
Apples are 75 cents for each pound. So every pound, so this is a kind of a slope. It is a slope right here. It's a rate. Every pound I buy, okay, x is going to represent pounds in just a second. Every pound I buy, the price goes up by
75 cents.
Over 1 pound, up 75. That's a slope. Over 1 and up 75 cents. But that slope's kind of funny. We can make it a better looking slope. We'll do that in a second.
Oh,
you going to say something? All right, so the first thing that it asks us to do is to choose between these two equations, given the description of the situation where we go to some place, we pay $5 to get in, and every pound of apples that we pay 75 cents for every pound. So what equation would make sense if I were to say, oh, how much would it cost if I bought 17 pounds? Which equation would I want to plug 17 into? Hallie?
Would it be the second one?
Would it be the second one? What do you guys think?
Yeah.
Why?
Yeah.
Why?
Because
it's 75 cents per pound.
Yes.
And if x represents pounds, and not everybody's going to have more than, or they might have just 1 fee, entry fee. So.
So what are you saying about this one then?
It
won't work because you walk in and you pay it only once. Not more than once.
Jaden, what do you say? You were saying not everyone will have multiple entry fees, you said?
Yeah.
This would imply that there are multiple entry fees?
Yeah, and there's not an extra.
So that you would only pay the 75 once and 5 multiple times, which is not what happens. You pay the 5 once and 75 cents multiple times based on the test. Good. That's.
Boo.
You know, math used to be like when I was in school, when your parents were in school, it was about speed and getting the right answer, the right number answer. And calculating, basically doing everything that the internet does these days. Okay, what math is about now is about explaining yourself.
No.
Get used to it.
I don't know why, but my dad had a sheet that he had when he was like in the sixth or seventh grade.
Mm-hmm.
And he just, one day he found it and he showed it to me and it was like some weird stuff I've never seen. And he was doing other stuff that we haven't even learned yet in sixth and seventh grade.
Whether you like it or not, that is the concentration of math today, explaining yourself mostly. Okay? So, keep not liking it.
I'm just going to hate it.
It's going to be helpful.
Can you agree with Karen?
Yeah, absolutely. It's not a theory, it's what math actually is. Okay. So now we're going to look at the graph. We're going to think about the situation that we're talking about. How much would it cost you if you went to this place to get some apples, but you never got any apples?
$5.
Yeah, we're costing the $5 because you paid $5 to get in, and for some reason you didn't pick any apples. I don't know why.
That's a waste of $5.
So 0 pounds still costs you $5. Okay. All right, let's say, all right, this is the x-axis, this represents pounds. If I move over to X is 1, that means I pick 1 pound. How much will I pay for the pound of apples?
75 cents.
How much do I pay to get in?
$10.
So if I move over to 1 pound, I'm going to have to move up 75 cents. Y represents dollars. Okay. But that's kind of an awkward thing to do. Right? Notice, if I were to just keep moving over by 1 pound, I'll notice a nice little pattern happens. Move over 1 more pound. 1 more pound from there. I'm going to move up another 75 cents, because that's another pound, another 75 cents, right? And that costs another 75 cents. So what do I get? If I go up 75 cents more, well, I get up to, well, if you think about just the pounds and how many dollars it costs, it costs $1.50, right? Well, it's 2 times 75 cents is $1.50. If I move over another pound, I'm going to go up another 75 cents. That's going to put me at 225 just for the apples. $5 plus 225 for crazy. But once I get to 4 pounds, and I go up another 75 cents from there, 4 pounds of apples cost you how many dollars? Cost you how many dollars? Just the apples part, not the admission part, but if you just bought 4 pounds of apples, how much would it cost you? Yeah?
$3.
So we had 75 cents
times four.
$3 plus 5 will be 8 total, and that's what we see here, 8 total. 4 pounds, $5 for admission, $3 for the apples, we're up to $8. So instead of moving over 1 and up 75 cents, it could just from here move over how much? From there I could just move over, instead of just $1, how many dollars could I move over?
What do you say?
Instead of moving over $1 from here, I could move over more than one. How many dollars could I move over? What did we just notice about going from here to here? 4 pounds costs
$3.
$3.
Three.
Okay.
Right.
So instead of keeping just moving over one and one and one and one, how about if I moved over 4 more pounds? How much would 4 more pounds cost me?
$3.
$3 more for a total of $6 more. Admission. $4 or 4 pounds, another $3. How about 4 more pounds?
$3 more.
Right, just seeing this increase just like step by step. 4 pounds cost $3. Move over 4 pounds, move up $3. Over 4 pounds, up $3. Just keep going, but however many lots of 4 pounds you want to buy, you can just keep going up and over that way. That'll keep on going for as long as you want. We do not have all eternity. So yes, I'm gonna cheat. Draw that line. Because I know if I were to fill in all the gaps with all those points, that's the shit I'd like after it. If I were to draw the rest of this line and go back 4 pounds and down $2. So I can buy them a pound at a time and pay 75 cents, but if I only like if I only have $1 bills, then I'm gonna have to buy 4 pounds or how many pounds?
You can get change back.
How much does 4 pounds of apples cost?
$3.
So if I don't have anything but dollar bills and they don't have any change other than dollar bills. If I only have dollar bills and they only have dollar bills. What's that?
$3
and how many pounds do they give me? 4 pounds. So I'd always buy 4 pounds. If I want more than that, I should buy how many pounds?
Eight pounds.
If I want more than that, I should buy
12 pounds,
right? Buy them in lots of 4 pounds, because I know that's going to be just around $3. Right at $3. No change needed. I don't need to give them change, they don't have to give me back change. Amounts of dollars. Okay. Now we can see that 4 and 3 relationship. If we just write 0.75 as a fraction, what's 0.75 as a fraction? 0.75 as a fraction.
That's
3/4. 3/4. 3/4 is the fraction. If I divide 3 by 5, 3 by 4, I'll get 0.75. 3/4. 3/4 x plus 5. Look at that. 4 pounds. 4 pounds costs you $3. I can see that relationship right there in the fraction form. Written in a fraction form, I can see that over and up. Or if it's negative, over and down relationship. Right there.